Let us pray. Amazing God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and our redeemer. Amen. Grace and peace to you from God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I suppose it is time for us to answer one of the greatest theological questions of all time. Who does God love more, Michigan or Notre Dame? I should have seen this coming, but I didn't. When I first flew here to interview in person with the search committee, I remember flying over the Notre Dame Stadium while they were playing Purdue. Notre Dame won 20-17, by the way. I saw what looked from the air was a massive oval of people, all these little dots packed in around a little green field. We were descending to land at the South Bend Regional Airport, so I could even see the little dots that were the players running around on the field. It looked exciting, and I felt like I could feel the energy of the game sitting there in my seat at 12B. Then when I came off of the plane, I'm fairly certain that I remember Bob Schaefer picking me up from the airport wearing a Michigan jacket. That was another clue to this great theological quest, I am certain now, but I didn't see it at the time. There were other clues that this question was coming. One weekend when there was a big playoff game involving Notre Dame, I remember that a group of us were eating at the Great Wall Chinese restaurant after service on Sunday, and Phyllis Gordon gave me a great big Notre Dame button. She walked up to me and pinned it on me and said, "Now you're ready for the big game tonight." Another clue came almost a year later when I was invited to one of Amy Sturma and Janet Pontius' infamous Saturday night football parties. They project the game onto the garage door and pull out lawn chairs and watch the games outside in the fall. There I was watching the game on a screen that was 16 feet wide and 7 feet tall. The players were literally larger than life. Notre Dame was playing Michigan that night. Out there on the driveway watching the game, the lines of allegiance were firmly drawn by the colors everyone was wearing. Michigan won 41-30, by the way. And of course, there was a fair amount of the trash talk that accompanies every game. The tension that arises every time one person's team is making a pivotal play, and the happy dance that follows by the fans of whoever's team scores or gets that ever-precious first down. Kathy Lynn Grossman wrote a piece for the Religious News Service that was published on the Sojourners Magazine website that cites a survey from the Public Research Religion Institute. The title of Grossman's piece was "Fans Rely on God, Rituals to Boost Favorite Team." This piece really looked at the intersection of team spirit and spirituality. The survey involved 1,011 English and Spanish speaking people during the second week of this January. This survey identified that 60% of Americans call themselves fans of a particular team. Grossman notes, among this group, several will do a little dance or say a little prayer to help the team along. The survey discovered that football fans are more likely to admit praying for their team than anybody else. 33% of football fans admit praying for the outcome of a game, as opposed to 21% of other sports. 25% of football fans have some sort of pre-game or game time ritual. The survey also noted that 31% believe that their team could possibly be cursed. One in four football fans admit to doing something to try to ensure that their team will win. She notes things like wearing their lucky team jersey or wearing a particular pair of underwear for every game. And it turns out that 26% say they pray to God to help their team win. And actually, white evangelicals lead the way, with a whopping 38% of them praying for God's favor to fall on their chosen teams. Grossman reports, although 3/4 of the respondents said God plays no role in who wins, Americans are evenly divided on whether God rewards faith-filled athletes with good health and success, with 48% saying yes and 47% saying no. There is this idea in our culture that God can be persuaded to choose one team over the other, that God's favor will be given to the more faithful fans or players, that God has a stake in who wins and who loses. The fans who pray are, by doing so, saying that the results on the field can be affected, basically, by the depth of their devotion. We all want our favorite teams to win. But does it make sense to think that God would use the outcome of a football game to levy some sort of cosmic justice for reward and punishment? This week was a week from hell. And our community was shocked into the realization of yet another terrible shooting. At the Martin's grocery store at 3900 East Bristol Street, 3 people lost their lives and our entire community lost another layer of its innocence. Crystal Dykes, Rochelle Godfrey, and Sean Baer are all dead. And I truly believe that our God weeps for the loss of all 3 of their precious, precious lives. The authorities and the media are trying to figure out how and why something like this could ever happen. While working on the investigation, many have been quick to note the heroic actions of our police force and the employees at the store, who most certainly responded with bravery, and we thank God they were able to prevent the loss of even more life on that terrible Wednesday. And yet this senseless violence releases the fear of a community onto itself. The sheer randomness of the act exposes us to the idea that this could happen to any one of us at any time. Perhaps that's why we are so determined to find out the how and the why of it all. I mean, if there can be a reason for the shooting, for the terrible loss of life, then perhaps we can find some comfort in excluding ourselves from this ever happening to us. The search for the truth leads many to question God. How could God ever allow something like this to happen? It's a question, as they say, of theodicy. The Concise Encyclopedia tells us that theodicy is the argument for the justification of God, concerned with reconciling God's goodness and justice with the observable facts of evil and suffering in our world. And this week, we have seen evil and suffering. And yet, we claim to believe in an amazing God. Some will say that there is a reason for everything, that everything is not merely a matter of chance, and that even this terrible act is somehow part of God's plan. As skewed as this view may sound, I do believe that its purpose is to provide some sense of comfort to the person who claims it. And I support that. When they interview people after a tragedy like this, as they always do, there always appears to be someone who will say something to the effect of, I always go to that store at that time of day, and today something told me not to go. So I didn't. God must be watching out for me. God had plans for me, and it wasn't my time to go. They are comforted by the idea that even if it is terrible and beyond our comprehension, that somehow and in some way, everything is, just as it should be, is beyond our control, and that our role in this journey called life is to accept it, knowing that all is well, even in the dark times. I don't personally see life this way. While I appreciate the comforting need it fulfills, the sense of relief from the random chaos of life and our fear of powerlessness in an ever-increasingly violent and chaotic world, it also devalues the lives of the people who were killed. In a way, this final thought says that their lives were over, but these lives over here were not. It says that in some mind-boggling way, God was intervening on behalf of these people over here and purposely choosing to not intervene on behalf of Crystal and Rochelle and Sean. One alternative is to accept the sheer randomness of life. The idea that chaos and suffering can erupt at any time and affect any one of us, and that we are powerless to do anything against it. This is a terrifying thought for most people, the idea that we are powerless in the light of such an awful act of violence. And we don't want it to be a random act of violence, because if it is, then we are all at risk in ways that we most understand don't want to even begin to imagine. The very idea that God would stand by and let such atrocities happen for no particular reason is maddening. God must have been doing something, right? There has to be a reason, and this all must be a part of some grand plan. If not, then chaos appears to rule the day, and the extreme response to this line of thought is that we are all surely doomed with the darkness of violence, with no recourse to save ourselves or others. But there is another way. Our reading today from the book of the prophet Isaiah actually shows us the way. A way of understanding how to react when bad things happen in a beautiful world made by God. A way that reconciles the violence we experience in this life with the power to do something about it. And it's focusing on where the power is that allows us to find a way to find comfort in the face of such a senseless tragedy, without, I believe, falling into the trap of believing that God simply must play favorites and even condones violence for God's own purposes, all so that we can find some sort of comfort and blessed assurance. The prophet begins, "Listen to me, all coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born, while I was in my mother's womb. God named me." We have many stories of God naming people in the Bible. Abram and Sarai become Abraham and Sarah. Jacob becomes Israel after wrestling with the angel. In the New Testament, when Jesus renames Simon, Peter. There's a lot of power in a name. When God or Jesus renames someone, it is because they've experienced a change in their life path that has so totally changed how they live their lives that their old name simply doesn't fit anymore. And to name someone is to know them, to know who they are and who you hope for them to be. Every mother who has named a child knows what that feels like. That's what the prophet reveals here for us today, that our God knew us before we were born and that we were a part of God's plan for the world. The prophet continues. "He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver he hid me away. He said to me, 'You are my servant Israel, in whom I will be glorified.'" just as I was trying to explain to Seamus. Making a polished arrowhead takes a lot of care and work, a lot of attention to detail, intentionality, and purpose. And in such a way, we have been made in the image of God by God. As a cherished tool meant for the crafting and care of the world that we live in. This image of being held in God's hands after being named by God while we are in our mother's womb is one of the most beautiful and loving images in all of Scripture. God is always with us, the prophet says. And yet, just like all of us, the prophet does express some doubts, the prophet says. But I have said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. And surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with my God? This proclamation of the prophet is attributed to a time when the Hebrew people were living in exile in Babylon. That's when the middle section of the book of Isaiah was written, they believe. And they had been conquered by the Babylonians and forced to leave their beloved homeland and to live as slaves in Babylon in exile. In part here, what we have is a captured people's dream for how they can be restored to their homeland and their former way of life, freed of captivity, worshiping once again in a temple that needed to be rebuilt. We can use this same inspiration to dream of a day when we are free of the terrible gun violence that plagues our city and our nation. Here what we have is the hope of an enslaved people that simply by the act of their creation as God's children, that they have what it takes inside of them to restore order and justice in the world in spite of the terrible circumstances that they are living in slavery. This reading ends with God reassuring the captives in Babylon and us today that our relationship with God, that we have the power to change the world. The prophet reflects on the words of the Lord in the good book says, and now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. And God says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up simply the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. No, I will give you as a light to all the nations that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Remembering again that you were formed in the womb to be God's servant, to be servants of restoration and justice where God is our strength, we find that we are charged with bringing about God's will on earth. That we are called to be the agents of change and compassion. It is not simply a matter of God choosing what is to happen. It is up to us to fulfill our promise for the world as God's servant. Finding the strength that comes from our God, finding the talents to serve and to help others that our amazing God formed in us while we were in our mother's womb. Finding in our hearts the name that our God gave us when he was carefully and intentionally crafting us into agents of peace and justice for a broken world. I can safely say that God does not love any team over that of another. God does not take sides. I can also say with confidence that our amazing God doesn't support any act of violence as a part of some grand plan for some manifestation of a twisted God, little g, will. Our God is a God of peace and not violence, of love and not hate, of mercy and not suffering. But for us as Christians, the love of God as revealed to us through his only Son, Jesus Christ, is the answer. I went to the vigil last night and stood there in the snow. I think Nick and I got there at about 7:45, 15 minutes before it was going to begin. And we were already probably 50 to 75 people deep from the center of the gathering. By the time 8 o'clock came, there were 50 to 75 people deep behind us trying to approach the gathering. It was cold. We all huddled together. Some guy was handing out these yellow roses with little red tips on them. He was just walking around holding out a bucket. And there was a couple of women who I don't believe knew each other. They were obsessed with handing out candles. They were quiet, just walking around. Pray for God to show you how to make a difference in the world. Pray for the families who are experiencing such poignant loss, and I mean all three families. Pray for our community, for our nation. And pray for a way to become God's vessel, to bring about God's will that isn't a random act. It is a choice when every faithful Christian stands up and says, I am called by God to do something like this or something like that so that I can bring about a new heaven and a new earth, so that I can bring about peace and justice and mercy, so I can end suffering, so I can in some small way, even if I'm not dealing with a gun in my hand, doing something that brings about an act of love that I know when I let it out there is going to do something to change the world to make it better than if I didn't do it in the first place. We don't know why a gun was fired. We don't know why these people died. We don't even know how it all connects to the greater story of all the stories of our lives in this city at this point. But I do know each and every one of those lives needed more love in them, because we always need more love. And as a disciple of Jesus Christ, I firmly believe that what Jesus taught what are you going?